We'll continue from the last lecture where we have left with, we said we will be starting with the TCP congestion control. So far, does anyone have got any doubts on networking? Whatever we have done till the last class? So far it's clear? Okay, let's move on. Now this is the principle of congestion control. What is congestion controls? Yes, very true. So when we have lot of traffic in our network, then that is what we call it as congestion. Something like which is stopping the flow of the data. So what are the principles of congestion control? Informally, too many sources sending too much of data, too fast, or too many informations which is going. So for the network to handle, different from flow control, manifestations, lost packets or long delays. There could be two reasons for this. What is? You could lose certain packets of informations, or there could be some long delays in reaching in your informations, because if there are too many informations that you are passing through it, which is a major problem in the networking. The causes and cost of congestions: two senders, two receivers. Okay, you have two senders, two receivers, one router, infinite buffers, no retransmission, large delays when congested, maximum achievable throughput. So what we can see it here is that what we are seeing it, this is the maximum congestions, the throughput that we are receiving it. So because of that, we will have a drop in our networking. So these are the certain scenarios based on which we there are certain principles that has been or there is some implementation process that has been worked on. Now what are the other causes and costs of congestions? One router and finite buffers. Sender retransmits lost packets. So if you have the buffer feasibility, if you have finite buffers, then what you can do is you can still retransmit your lost packets. But in this case also, you can, there is a probability that you may lose out on your informations. Some packets may get lost. So what is it? What is lambda in equal to lambda out, which is the most expected one, we know it. Perfect retransmissions only when lost. So if there is something, some delta is lost, then we send it as an output. Retransmissions of delayed, not lost packets makes lambda in larger than perfect case for the lambda out. Means whatever you are sending it in, and the same amount of packets or informations needs to be come out. But in that case, it you may have certain cases where you may lose the packets. That means your lambda in, whatever has come in, but the output is lesser than the input. And other cases is that you may retransmit those input informations, but that will, what will it will cause? It will cause the delay of your complete transformations from one end to the other end, because you are retransmitting the same packets again and again. So till then you don't get all the information, so that creates a delay. So cost of congestions depends on more work retransmission for a given good, but unneeded retransmission link carries multiple copies of packets. Now we have few approaches towards congestion control. End-to-end congestion control. No explicit feedback from network. Congestions inferred from end system observe. Loss, delay, approach taken by TCP. So we will be learning further that there are few congestion control network which has been implemented by the TCP. There are two things, TCP and UDP. They are the two networking protocols that we will be using it to. Or you can say these are the transformation layers. Transformation layers that will be that implements this end-to-end congestion control. And network assisted congestion control, routers provide feedback to end system, single bit indicating congestions, explicit rate sender should use for sending informations. Now for TCP congestion control, what are the essential strategy? The TCP host sends packets into the network without a reservation, and then the host reacts to observable in events. IDEA assumes best effort network, FIFO or FQ routers. Each source determines network capacity for itself. ACKS pace transmission. ACKS is what? Nothing but an acknowledgement. And challenges determine the available capacity in the first place. They could be slow start and adjust to challenges in the available capacities, AIMID. What is it? Additive informations and multiple controls. Multiplicative control, basically. So FIFO means first in, first out. Okay, so whatever the packets what comes in, first that will be transmitted if there is any congestions or blocks. So it will leave out those remaining part of the packets which cannot be further transmitted because of the congestions. So those packets will get lost or they will be stopped transmitting. And why do we need acknowledgement? We need acknowledgement just to support whether whatever you are sending it, yes, you have received it. So that is the reason that acknowledgement is very much required. And we have earlier also went through those, that based on those acknowledgement, the round trip time is been calculated and other timings have been calculated, that how much time it will take for any informations to flow in the network. TCP congestion control goal, TCP sender should transmit as fast as possible but without congestion network. That is the main goal of any clean network, we can say it, or any fast network that we can think of it. Issue, how to find rate just below congestion level. Each TCP sender sets its window size based on implicit feedback. So whatever the feedback or whatever the RTD that we calculate based on all those samplings and all. So there is, for every TCP we try to set up a window size. Why? Because somewhere the congestions may be more, somewhere the congestion is very less. Accordingly the window size needs to be restructured. Otherwise if you give the bandwidth to all places the same, then it will be, there may be a wastage of those bandwidths. So we have to work on based on our samplings, or based on the RTT time that we have been calculated previously. So all these factors, so these are basically implicit feedback. So based on these feedbacks or based on these sampling statistical data that we create all those types of TCP window size for the TCP. Now acknowledgement send segment received, network is not congested, so increase sending rate. Loss segment assumes loss due to congestion, so decrease sending rate. So these are the two options. If my acknowledgement segment received, network is not congested, so increase sending rate. So you can, that means you have the capacity to send more information, so you can increase it. But in case if there is a loss, What we need to do it? We need to decrease it. This is a simple mathematical equations. TCP congestion control, probing for bandwidth, increase transmission rate receipt of ACK until eventually loss occurs, then decrease transmission rate. So what we can do is, we can incrementally keep increasing it, but once we see again there is a loss, we can immediately decrease the rate. So that also algorithms can be implemented so that we can control our flow. You will detect the loss because all those ultimately when we are going to come across all those equations, how are we going to detect the loss, how, what are the delays, your packets, yes, all that is there, it's coming up. Now we have, what we have now is the additive increase and multiplicative decrease. When do you need to increase it and when do you need to decrease it? So this is one of the properties of handling your congestions window. So objective, adjust to changes in the available capacity. New state variable per connections is congestions window. So going forward we will be using this as CWND, which is nothing but a congestions window. That window is the window which we need to calculate. And how do we do it? That is what we are going to see it down the line. Limits, how much data source has in transmit. So max, maximum window is minimum congestion window and the advertised window. Effective window is maximum window minus last byte sent minus last byte acknowledged. So these are the things, before setting all these things, you have to do all these calculations, you have to find it out. You are doing an RTT, last time when what we have looked into, we have done the RTT calculations, we have done the sampling calculations, that how are we doing the sampling. So based on all these values only, then only you will be able to set your effective window. Increase congestion window when congestion goes down and decrease congestion windows when congestion goes up. Congestion window is set based on the perceived level of congestions. So host receives implicit packet drop or explicit packet mark as an indications of internal congestions. Additive increase. Additive increase is a reaction to perceived available capacity referred to as congestions avoidance stage. Frequently in the literature, additive increase is defined by a parameter alpha, where the default is alpha equal to 1. That is a linear increase, we increase by 1. Or we, that is basically we are doubling it up. Whatever it is, 1 plus 1, we are doubling it up. Linear increase for each congestion windows, worth of packets sent, increase congestion window by 1 packet. So every time you keep on increasing, till then the moment you say there is a failure, you again start decreasing it. In practice, congestion window is increased fractionally for each arriving acknowledgement. So this is the increment that you are going to calculate it. So it's like you are sending once packet to source from destinations, you have received the acknowledgement. Now you, since you have received the acknowledgement on time before your timeout, now you can send now two packets and see whether you are getting it. The moment there is a failure in this sending and receiving it, you go back to your original default size. Now multiplicative decrease. Key assumption, a dropped packet and resultant timeout are due to congestion at a router. Frequently in the literature, multiplicative decrease is defined by a parameter beta, where the default is 0.5. Decreases you may decrease it by half, not by full but by half, but increase by double. That is the main logic of increasing and decreasing. Multiplicative decrease, TCP reacts to a timeout by half of the congestion window. Although defined in bytes, the literature often discuss congestion window in terms of packets, or more formally in maximum segment size. Congestion window is not allowed below the size of a single packet, which is a beyond that, that means you are not sending anything. Zero packet means you are not sending anything. One is the least packet that you are going to send across the network. Clear so far? It has been shown that additive increase and multiplicative decrease is a necessary condition for TCP congestion control to be stable, because the simple CC mechanism, congestion control mechanism, involves timeouts that cause retransmission. It is important that hosts have an accurate timeout mechanism. If you don't have that timeout mechanism, then what will happen? You will not know when to retransmit the data. So it's a logic. Like if you have to do the next step, before that you have to know the end step of it, or the controlling process. So the controlling step is what? The congestion window and your timeout factor. Timeout set as a function of average RTT and standard deviations of RTT. Right? TCP hosts only sample round trip time once per RTT using coarse grained clock. That is a method they use it for calculating it. So basically, if you see the pattern, it will look like a sawtooth. Once you are increasing, decreasing, increasing, decreasing, so as per that, it will almost look like a sawtooth. Okay, now we have certain processes by which we can the congestion control can be worked out. A is that something like slow start. Slow start means you generally come back to congestion window as 1. So you keep increasing, 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 and then you come back again to, if the moment there is a failure, you come back to 1. So that is what is called as a slow start. So you are starting from the beginning. Linear. No, these are all the processes. Now, what are the implementations? Which one you will be taking up and finally implementing in your networking pattern? In network pattern, what will you be implementing it? So, one is that you have the congestion window, two options. One is either come to the slow start. So, it's slow start means you come to 1 from the beginning. If you half it, then what do you have to do it? You have to reduce it and then again start doing it. So it is a midway. So based on that, now what your network best option works for it, you have to use it. Linear additive increase takes too long to ramp up a new TCP connection from cold start. It will definitely, if you go to back to your original set, so it will take the more time. Beginning with TCP Tahoe, these are the options you can say. There are TCP Tahoe, TCP Rane. So these are the names that has been Vegas. So these are the name which they have given as a network protocol. The slow start mechanism was added to provide an initial exponential increase in the size of congestion window. Remember, mechanisms by slow start prevents a slow start. Moreover, slow start is slower than sending a full advertised window's worth of packets all at once. The slow start starts with congestion window 1. Every time an acknowledgement arrives, it is incremented. 2 slow start situations at the very beginning of a connection, it is called cold start. When the connection goes dead, waiting for a timeout to occur, that is when the advertised windows goes to zero. Okay? So this is how it is. However, in the second case, the source has more information, the current value of congestion window can be saved as a congestion threshold. So you can set up also a threshold limit for it. This is also known as a slow start threshold. So what you have here is, so this is your congestion window, okay? So you start with slow start, that is one. So it goes on, it keeps on incrementing. At this point your segments gets lost. So where the timeout happens. And then what you can do is, you come back to your slow start, you start with again the flow. So if you see it, this is what we discussed about is divided by 2, which is point half of it. No, initially we are not setting up any threshold. So what is the threshold? How do we set up the threshold? First it is increasing. Okay, it went to a point where the packet started failing. So where my timeout also started happening. So then what I am coming back to my zero initial state, I am starting again. Also I know it, there is another way option is where I have half of it. So I could have come back to that and again could have gone back. But instead of that, the slow start allows you to come back to the origin. Yes, multiplicative drop and the additive drop. So when it is coming back to the additive drop, then when again it is increasing, so I can set up a limit as congestion's avoidance limit, which is that half of it. When it comes to that stage, then I can readjust again my, so that I avoid my happening of congestions, future congestions. So that is set as a threshold limit. Clear, everyone? This graph is clear? Okay. Be very careful because questions get twisted on this. And if you are not clear of the concepts, then it's going to create a issue down the line. So if you see it, this is how the behavior of TCP congestion control. It went up, timeout happened, came down, again it slowly it is increasing your congestions window. Okay, so it's almost like a saw. Now, next is fast retransmit. One we saw it as a slow start, the second one is fast retransmit. What is it? Coarse timeouts remained a problem and fast retransmit was added with TCP Tahoe. We'll learn about this TCP Tahoe and Rane down the line. So first, before that, we understand what are the types of congestions control. One is slow start, now this is the fast retransmit. Since the receiver responds every time a packet arrives, this implies the sender will see duplicate ACKs. Last time what we have gone through it, then we will wait for 3 duplicate ACKs and then post which we will do a transmit. And there is another way of understanding when my duplicate ACK is happening and then transmit it immediately. So instead of waiting for getting a 3 duplicate acknowledgement or 5 duplicate acknowledgement, whatever the limit you set it. So basically you use your duplicate acknowledgement as a signal that some packets has been lost and transmit that packet immediately. So what is it? Upon receipt of 3 duplicate acts, the TCP sender transmits a lost packet. Fast retransmit eliminates about half the coarse grain timeouts. This yields roughly a 20% improvement in throughput. Note, fast retransmit does not eliminate all the timeouts due to small window size at the source. This is how it is. Packet 1 send, acknowledgement received. Packet 2 send, acknowledgement received. Packet 3 got lost. I've sent packet 4. I'm receiving acknowledgement 2 only. Why? Because it is in sequential order. So packet 3 has not received, it will not send acknowledgement, even if you keep sending your packets. So this is what we need to identify, that okay, act 2 has been acknowledgement 2, that means 2 packets have received, third packet has failed, rest others are going fine. So I will send the retransmit the packet 3. And then I will get it as an acknowledgement packet 6, because 456 has been accepted by the receiver. First is your 2 has lost, 3 is lost. So first it will keep sending you 3 unless and until you have not sent the 3. Once you have sent the 3, then it will, if your 5th is lost, it will send you pack acknowledgement of 4. It will keep sending you acknowledgement 4. So what you are supposed to do it, then again send. Yes, it will keep sending 4. Continuously till then you don't send the 5th one. It is doing it sequentially. So it has to, after 4 it will not send you acknowledgement of packet 6. Till then your packet 5 was not received. So that is how it helps us also to retransmit the packets properly and in short time. You can set it 3, 5, 3. Why do we keep it? Because it, then you have the time also, no? If you wait for that acknowledgement to come 5 times, your time limit is also increasing. Your time limit, number of times your acknowledgement, that failure acknowledgement, that packet 2 has not received, packet 2 has not received, packet 2 has not. So the more you increase the number of times, more you have, your wait time will be there. So you have to work on what is, whatever the best we can handle it. So but here what they are taking it as 3 as the. Why 3? They are giving also that window time, that within 1 or 2 if it accepts it, if it reaches by then, so that at least that failure will not come. So again that window time also you have to give it. For some reason it got delayed to reach. So this is how it is traced in for the fast retransmit. Then you have fast recovery. Fast recovery was added with TCP Reno. Basic idea, fast retransmit detects 3 duplicate acts, start the recovery process from congestion avoidance region and use acts in the pipe to pace the sending of packets. Now congestion avoidance window. What is that congestion avoidance? What we have seen it some. This is that congestion avoidance window where I am setting it. This is a threshold limit which I am sending it. So what I can do is I can send it, the fast recovery means I can send it from that point and send it back my packets after analyzing which packet has been lost. So what is fast recovery? After fast retransmit half CWND condition window and commence recovery from this point using linear additive increase primed by leftover axon pipe. Now next is modified slow start. With fast recovery, slow start only occurs at cold start after a coarse grain timeout. This is the difference between TCP Tahoe and TCP Reno. So far what we have covered in TCP congestion control summary, congestion occurs due to a variety of circumstances. TCP interacts with routers in the subnet and reacts to implicit congestion notification by reducing the TCP sender's congestion window. TCP increases congestion window using slow start or congestion avoidance. These names sounds interesting. Interesting? Tahoe, Reno, Vegas. Vegas means we want to go to Las Vegas. Yeah. Reno is a lake, yes. So they have taken up a place name and yeah. So interesting, right? So what is the learning objectives that we have it from here? Evolutions of TCP's congestion control, TCP Tahoe, TCP Reno and TCP Vegas. To add to these TCP flavors, we have others also which works over all these three things, which is TCP New Reno, TCP SAC, Segmented Acknowledgement, TCP Vegas, TCP Big, TCP Cubic. These are used by Linux, and TCP Compound used by Windows. I will not be covering up everything, but I will be covering till TCP Vegas. Rest, any other informations, please Google it out. So what is there in TCP Tahoe? It is SS slow start plus AI. AI is threshold. Okay. Additive increase plus fast retransmit. Okay. TCP Reno is again combinations of all three plus fast recovery. TCP Reno, New Reno is Reno plus partial acknowledgement. SAC is Reno plus selective acknowledgement. And FAC is Reno plus forward acknowledgement. Now, how these each one of them are different from each other and what had controlled, I mean, how this has improved on and which one to be used, that we are going to now see, look into each one of them. Loss indicated by, so TCP detecting, how do we detect, how do we react to loss? Loss indicated by timeout. So what we have it is CWND set to 1 MSS. Window then grows exponentially as in slow start to threshold, then grow linearly. Loss indicated by 3 duplicate acts, TCP Reno. Duplicate acts indicates network capable of delivering some segments. And congestion window is cut in half window, then grows linearly. This is an interesting diagram, okay? Have a look at it. It's starting from slow start. What is the congestion window value? Congestion window is 1, set to 1. You're sending data, you're receiving acknowledgement, you are increasing by, incrementing by 1. So it's a linear increment. When congestion window reaches to its threshold limit, greater than or equal to threshold, slow start threshold, it goes into congestion avoidance. So what is congestion avoidance at this stage? What I am doing is congestion window plus 1 by congestion window. So it comes to half of almost. Okay? From this position I keep sending data and receiving acknowledgement. If I reach out the timeout, if there is a timeout, even in the congestion avoidance window, so what I will do, I have to retransmit the data. So what I will do is, I'll come back to congestion window to 1, which is slow start, because Tahoe uses slow start. What we have looked into, slow start, additive increase and fast transmission. These are the three things. So slow start means all acknowledgement, remaining acknowledgements will go to slow start and it will again process. Yes, it is better you know this diagram so that you can explain it, when and how the TCP Tahoe works. So there is another option to add congestion avoidance window is that if I get any duplicate ACK greater than equal to 3, then what happens? I can do a fast retransmission. So what I will do, sending missing packet. Here what the threshold is, half of it, but I will go to the slow start and again start sending it through this path, through this purple path. Clear? Everyone clear with this? If you want me to repeat it, I can repeat it. Just keep this diagram in your mind so that this will help you clear out all your understandings of how the TCP Tahoe works and what are the three things on which it is based on. Three congestion control that it follows. What are they? Slow start, additive increase and fast retransmission. So let's see this example. Your 31th package is failed. Okay? You're sending 31 to 38, 31 has failed. This segment is lost. You're getting 7 duplicate acts. Of that, 31 failed, 31 failed, not received, not received, not received. Next, what? After 3 duplicate acts, retransmit 31. That is what we studied. After 3 duplicate acts, this will become your fast retransmission. And set your congestion control window to 1. As per the, if you remember the this thing diagram, it goes like this. Not the down one, up one. Fast retransmission is above. Yes. Okay. Then you are sending, then once you have sent that 31, you are getting an acknowledgement of 38, because that was the last one. Then you are resetting again to your congestion window to 1, slow start. After everything, all acknowledgement done, it comes to slow start. It's sending the 39th packet. Now we come to Reno. It is almost starting is the same. You start with it, but what is the difference? We have additional fast recovery. How it works, that we have to see. Okay, you're sending packets. Acknowledgement receiving greater than equal to congestion window, greater than equal to your threshold, so it's going to congestion avoidance. From this point you are having sending data packets at the rate of congestion window equal to congestion window plus half of 1 by congestion window. Not half, 1 by congestion window. It's basically twice, doubling it up almost. Almost doubling it up. Now if we get again greater than equal to 3 duplicate act, we have fast retransmissions. Here what we have, this additional fast recovery. How do I do it? How to get it? If the threshold is CWND by 2, that is I reach, go back to the half of it. I set that as a threshold now and send the missing packet from there on. This is the fast recovery. This is again sending data duplicate ACK. Non-duplicate acts coming back here. From here again, because it has to have after fast recovery, these are the one which are the lost packets. So it has to come back to your original state with. Yes, fast recovery is the lost packets which got transmitted. So it has to come back to your congestion avoidance window. Right? From there, if now the timeout happens within this, so again that retransmission, timeout, again from there, if there is any loss, it goes to 3 duplicate retro, fast retransmission. Circle is clear? So sender receives 3 duplicate acts. So what is the formula here? My congestion window is changed to total window size is 8 by 2 plus 3 packets. 3 packets of duplicate act. So which I am getting it as 4 plus 3, 7. So congestion window now has been set to 7. So I'll retransmit my 31. This is the 3 duplicate acts. Initially I got it, retransmit 31. Huh? First I had my failure, 3 duplicate acts. It went up, retransmission, no, it went to recovery. So what is the recovery value I am setting it to? This 7. From 7, further retransmissions will happen. new 3 packets. I will receive the acknowledgement of 38. That was the last packet which it has received. So this is what the scenario from slow to congestion avoidance. Goes up, threshold, reach, go up, come down. Fairness goal, if K TCP session shares same bottleneck link of bandwidth R, each should have an average rate of R by K. So what is it? What is TCP fair? Two competing sessions, additive increase gives slope of 1 as throughput increases, multiplicative decrease decreases throughput proportionately. So this is your equal bandwidth share between both high and low. And this is your congestion avoidance additive increase, this area. So your transmissions is happening as and when. So this is the area which is your avoidance area. TCP fairness and UDP, multimedia app often do not use TCP. They do not want rate throttled by congestion control because they don't, multimedia you cannot wait for any control or anything happen and then retransmit. You need a continuous flow. So they uses UDP. Instead use UDP means send audio video at constant rate, tolerate packet loss. They can tolerate the packet loss but they cannot tolerate the congestion. Any streaming does not tolerate the congestions but it can tolerate a packet loss. Fairness, parallel TCP connections. Applications can open multiple parallel connections between two hosts. Web browsers do this. Link of rate R with 9 existing connections. New app ask for 1 TCP. Get rate equal to R by 10. If I ask for additional TCP connections. Now how this performance of the bulk data transfer happens? This is like you are sending your information through a small pipe. So if your pipe is clogged, then your data won't flow. So what am I supposed to identify? What is the diameter of the pipe through which my water can flow? So same way, my bandwidth also depends on the width of the pipe, diameter of the pipe. So how do you compute the performance through bandwidth delay? Horizontal dimension is delay. Correct? Horizontal dimension. Vertical dimension is bandwidth. As I said, through this pipe when it flows, so that's a vertical dimension. That is the bandwidth. Delay is the pipe, that is the length of the pipe. Shaded area is the packet size. So bandwidth delay product is equal to pipe size, which is equal to bandwidth into round trip time. How it happens? Filling the network pipe. TCP sender, pipe for sending data packets, it fills the network. That this part, this pipe is filled by this. And when there is an highest performance is when the pipe is completely full. When the pipe is full, that is the point when there is an highest performance. Capacity of it is more. So more the dimension, it's a more your capacity. So more information. Beyond that, it is a threshold which has reached. But your pipe needs to be full. You cannot leave a space. That means you are less utilizing your capacity. So your best case scenario is when you have the pipe completely filled up. This is how it is. You have congestion window when it is 1, your first packet is going, so you have so much of space in between, less utilization. Then it went to the next step, it is going, so by this time it has reached. So your remaining 3 portion of that pipe is free. When it is 2 packets, yeah, below is acknowledgement layer. Below is acknowledgement layer and above is the sending informations. So if it is 2, then you are seeing it here 2, still some space is left, so not full utilization. And still there are so much of blank spaces. So when it is 3, it is still better. But when it is 31, 32, 33, so here in this case you will see it is almost getting full. So it is the maximum utilization of your bandwidth. And the best utilization of your pipe capacity basically. Problem of TCP bulk data transfer. Multiple packet loss, partial acknowledgement received when first packet retransmitted. Acknowledgement causes moving out of fast recovery state. Congestion control window half, wait for timeout, affects Reno performances. We have seen how the TCP Reno works, how the data flows in TCP Reno. Now this is what Reno's multiple packet loss problem. How it is, how the packets are lost, and this is an example through which you will be able to understand like how exactly the data is getting lost and when the data is getting retransmitted. Here the lost is 31 is lost and 33, 34, your case scenario where you said that if the fifth one gets lost. So 33 and 34 is lost. You are receiving a duplicate acts of previous one, 30. So on 3 duplicate acts, you retransmit 31. Then you will get what? Partial acknowledgement of 32, because why 32 partial acknowledgement? Because your 33 and 34 is failed. It has not received. So receiver replied the ACK of segment 32 when it receives the retransmitted segment 31. This is a partial ACK. Then sender exited the fast recovery and entered the congestion avoidance. It comes to the congestion avoidance, if you remember, from fast recovery to the congestion avoidance. What is happening is, I'm changing the congestion window to 4. But here what is happening, there are other packets which got lost, 34 and 35. That information is coming. It has to come and again it has to retransmit. So what is happening is, in this process I may have a timeout which will delay it. So what is the problem with this? Let's go through it. Solution to Reno's problem two problem scenarios where TCP reno burst three losses. Reno cannot recover from burst of three plus losses. Packets arriving out of order can yield duplicate acts when in fact there is no loss. New Reno solution try to determine the end of a burst loss. What is it? So what is the solution? TCP new Reno extended fast recovery phase. Do not exit fast recovery if you get a partial acknowledgement. Why? Because there are still two more packets that have failed. So don't rely on that partial acknowledgement. Wait for it. That is handled by the TCP new Reno concept. Then you have TCP SAC, explicitly acknowledge loss segments. TCP FAC is extensions of SAC which uses forward acknowledgement plus better estimations of available window. And TCP Vegas using real-time calculations to signal conditions. Now what is TCP new Reno? Here what has happened? Your packets 31, 33, 34 were lost. You received a 5 duplicate acts. On through 3 duplicate acts, I am sending the retransmission of 31. I have received a partial acknowledgement of 32. Then again I will retransmit 33 and 40 because I have not come back to the congestion window. I am waiting there. I will retransmit 33 and 40, and 40 is the new transitions. Then what I will do is congestion window I will increase by plus plus, so my next transaction will be 41. Again partial plus duplicate act 33, 34 is missing, I will retransmit 34. Then retransmit 42 and 43. Then acknowledgement of 40, 42, 43, 41 is missing, and 41 acknowledgement has not come, not partial, and exit from fast recovery, come back to congestion avoidance window. Now SAC, how is SAC different from new Reno? You are sending packets 31, 34, again that same scenario, lost. SAC gives an options that, like, you know, 32 I have received, 35 I have received, 32 I have received, so 31 is not there. So these numbers tells me that which is the one which I am not receiving it. So that number of packet, that number sequence number packet, I will retransmit. It should be 31. Yes. 32 has lost is 31. 32 has come properly. So this is an indication 32 has come properly. This is basically they have the patterns of sending the information. How many packets I am sending it at a time? 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. How many packets I am sending it at a time? So it's that number of counts which is giving. Send and receive. Okay? 35 and 35 send and receive. But I have not received 33 and 34. So this gives me an indication my 31, 33 and 34. So I don't have to wait for 3 duplicate act. The moment I see the number here, I can understand my 31 is lost. I can immediately resend the 31. Then I will receive a partial act of 32. Again, what I will do is retransmit the remaining two loss segments, 33 and 34, because I know those numbers from the first instance. So I will send first, retransmit, got that acknowledgement, retransmit the remaining two, get an acknowledgement, and then come back to my exit process. And what is the difference between forward acknowledgement? It is again the same scenario. Here I am getting it. Retransmit, it's only the difference is that I am retransmitting 31, forward acknowledgement of 35. Sender received two duplicate acts and began retransmitting the loss segments reported in the SAC option. This is advanced window for duplicate acts. Okay, that also I am setting it to 4, and then continued with my transactions and exit. So here the process is, since I have set forward acknowledgement 35. This is only the difference where I am sending it that. I have understood, I have resent 31, and immediately 33, 34 also I am resending it. I am not waiting for that acknowledgement. Okay, there I am waiting for the previous one SAC, I am waiting for it. What I am sending it, forwarding the remaining acknowledgement. So forwarding acknowledgement from 35 onwards. Sender calculated AWND, which is the avoidance window for received duplicate acts, and kept sending packets that are allowed. So I kept on sending all those packets. Now we have TCP Vegas. Clear till TCP Reno? SAC, FAC, any doubts on this? How the calculation is happening? We move on to TCP Vegas. Change in triggering fast retransmit. On receiving first duplicate act, check if current time minus, now this is with the timestamp, I am playing with the timestamp, if current time minus my sending time into minimum RTT is greater than timeout value. If this is greater than timeout value, trigger fast retransmit without waiting for the three duplicate acts. The catch is only I am doing a fast retransmit, I don't have to wait for three duplicate acts. Use of fine-grained RTT to improve congestion control. Fine-grained is that sampling of RTT that we have done it in the last session. Anticipate congestions based on minimum RTT. So how do you anticipate congestions? Base RTT equal to minimum RTT. Expected sending rate and actual sending rate. Expected is equal to congestion window divided by base RTT. Difference is equal to expected minus actual. If difference is less than A, congestion window equal to congestion window plus 1 per RTT. I am increasing it, additive increase. If difference is greater than B, then you just increment it. So A and B are two thresholds that control utilizations of bandwidth without overloading it. So other TCP variations are big, cubic, fast TCP, high speed TCP. These are some of them are evolving ones. Big and cubic are there. If you want to know more about it, you can run through your some Google's informations. So this is how your three-way handshake happens. Client, you're sending your packets. With this, you're sending a sequence number. You're attaching a sequence number. When you're getting an acknowledgement, data plus acknowledgement, and your sequence number is also changing to Y. Acknowledgement equal to X plus 1. And here the sequence number is 2 because this sequence number will send you the new packet. Okay, where the acknowledgement equal to Y plus Y1. Adaptive retransmission, RTT, round trip time between a pair of hosts on the internet, the initial TCP timeout value is an operating system parameter that is set very conservatively. How to set the timeout value? The timeout value is set as a function of the expected RTT. It could be a consequences of a bad choice also. So this, how to set the timeout value, that you have to do earlier whatever we have done is yes, maximum and the sampling of RTT into the sampling of RTT. So far what we have what we are completing in TCP congestion control summary. Congestion occurs due to a variety of circumstances. TCP interacts with routers in the subnet and reacts to implicit congestions. TCP increases congestions window. And these are the things what we have covered: Tahoe, Reno, and solutions to multiple problems of Reno, which is new Reno, SAC, and FAC. And Vegas is a one where we are sending it duplicate that formula estimated differences. We do not wait for 3 acknowledgement. TCP and congestion avoidance, random early detections, and ECN. TCP options, TCP timers, and socket programming. This is the last part of the TCP that we are going to run through it. Improving TCP congestion performance. TCP's congestion control is a guessing game. Need help from the network. Routers have to inform about congestions. Some notification, explicit notifications, or implicit notification. How do we do this in TCP/IP context? What happens at the routers? This is how it is. Your input device, you're forwarding your IP address, it goes to the output queuing, traffic control, then you have this queuing discipline and the policing of filtering and all that. That is also, this is your complete queuing discipline. So where the, how the queue data has to be queued, and what is the queuing logic, and what are the policies that you want to put it. So all that policing and all that discipline of the queuing is done in this area. So finally, after going through this traffic control and output queuing, it goes to the output device. Right, now what we understood about this is the complete traffic controlling. First in, first out. You can't do that because everything is going now as a packet. So ultimately at the end, what output, what you are supposed to do it, you have to add those headers, you have to create that original thing and then send it. You cannot send somebody as a packet. So you have to come set it as a whole and send it. So what you have to do is it has to be first in, first out. So what is the simplest approach? FIFO queue and drop trail queue. Drop trail, so FIFO, what we know it, it's in first in, first out. What is drop trail queue? Drop trail queue is, so the moment we reach that congestion's window, threshold, whenever we reach the congestion threshold, I know it, my queue is going to fail. So I can drop the remaining packets from there on. Yeah, restart with the remaining packets again. Once this queue is cleared, I'll take up the new set and, but before that, whatever the packets, instead of getting it lost, I can stop it there. Stop transmitting. Okay, instead of getting it lost in the way and again retransmitting it, what I can do is I can also find out the drop tail queue and from there onwards I start. I cut it and then I send that. Once that queue is cleared, I resend the next set. So bursty loss from drop tail queue. TCP depends on packet loss. Packet loss is indications of congestions. TCP additive increase drives network into loss. So drop tail leads to bursty loss, congested link, many packets encounter full queue, synchronization, many connections lose packets at once. So this too has got a lot of disadvantages. Because if you again you have to sequence them and you have to send it, and in that sequence if you do not sequence it properly, then the previous packets and this sync up will not happen. So there are a lot of synchronization issues, congestions issues. So again, that will also have got disadvantages. So slow feedback from drop tail queue. Feedback comes when buffer is completely full, even though the buffer has been filling up for a while. Plus the filling buffer is increasing RTT. And the variance in the RTT might be better to give early feedback. Get one or two flows to slow down, not all of them. Get these flows to slow down before it is too late. So what are the ways I have? One is the random early detections. How I can detect it early? Router notices that queue is getting full and randomly drops packets to signal congestions. Packet drop probability, this is how it is, drop probability increases as queue length increases. If buffer is below some level, don't drop anything. Otherwise, set drop probability as functions of queue. Now, how do you compute read? Average length equal to 1 minus weight into average length plus weight into sample length. Where weight is less than 0 and greater than 1. Sample length is the length of the queue when a sample measurement is made. In most software implementation, the queue length is measured every time a new packet arrives at the gateway. In hardware, it might be calculated at some fixed sampling interval. This weight is nothing but a weighted running average. Okay? So read has two queue length thresholds, minimum threshold and maximum threshold. If average length is less than equal to minimum threshold, queue the packet. If minimum threshold is less greater than average length and which is less than maximum threshold, calculate the probability. Drop the arriving packet with probability P. So what you can do is you can drop those packets based on the probability that this 5 or 6 may be getting lost. So based on that probability, you can drop those 5 packets. If maximum threshold is greater than or equal to average length, drop the arriving packets. So based on this logic, you can queue manage your packets, when to drop and when to send. So this is how it is. This is your average queue length. So what we have seen is minimum threshold. If average queue length is less than equal to minimum threshold, so this is your minimum threshold. If this is less than this, so you keep queue the packet. You have that bandwidth to send it, no issue. Now you have average length, which is between minimum threshold and maximum threshold. In this case, when your average queue length is between these two, you calculate the probability drop. Which point the probability drop will happen, which is this max of P. So based on this, you can avoid sending those packets. And if you have maximum threshold where the average length is greater than this, drop the arriving packets. So how do you calculate the drop probability? This is a formula for calculating the drop probability. Max P into average length minus minimum threshold. Maximum threshold minus minimum threshold. So probability is equal to 10p divided by 1 minus count into 10p. Count is the number of packets queued since last drop. How many packets that have been queued? So this is what the formula for your drop probability. Now how do we set the parameters? Weighted average, weighted queue. So which is less than equal to 0.001 and industry standards. So minimum threshold, maximum threshold depend on the desired average queue size. If it is bursary traffic, increase minimum threshold to maintain link utilization. Maximum threshold depends on the maximum average delay allowed. Most effective, read is most effective when maximum threshold minus minimum threshold is larger than typical increase in calculated average queue size in one round trip time. So what is the rule of thumb? Maximum threshold at least twice the minimum threshold. Setting max P, read performs best when packet marking probability changes fairly slowly as the average queue size changes. This is a stability argument that read with small max P will reduce oscillation in average and actual marking probability. So max P is recommended to be less than equal to 0.1. These are the standard settings that is being recommended. So if you see this example, how it is working? Yes, these are all packet. This is the package queues. Maximum is 4, minimum is queue is minimum is 1. So you, these are your cues, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are your packets, drop P equal to 0 and then probability is also 0. Okay, fine. What I'll do is I'll continue with this from the next session and